again, that shot there. Don't ever take liberties with that. Don't make a habit of doing that. Very risky shot too. Just a fraction too much pace, and that white comes up and covers the spot, and then of course the red goes down the table. Now I've got options here. I could screw back, or I could run through gently, gentle pot, and that's what I've done in this case. Plenty of left hand side there. You see, and that turns the white and gives you the angle on the red. My word, that one only just got there. And the strange thing is with this top of the table that whilst you could look at this play and think, well, there are so many shots all the same there, well, they are same-ish, if you like, but they all demand something different. There are no two shots the same. See, and that shot there, that was nicely judged to catch the edge of the white, to give it a little nudge back towards the spot, because we were coming too close to this side of the table. And you can see now the white is just slightly out of position. So I've a gentle cannon, stun up. Now see if I can somehow just nudge it back a little bit. So I've pushed it up almost beside the red, and that'll give me the opportunity now. I've got the two balls close together. Now I play thick on the red with left hand side. Now the white being a little further down the table, again I pinched a bit of angle there with a touch of right hand side, and that's given me a little more command of the situation by playing with left hand side thick on the red. You see, and all the time I'm amassing points here without a great deal of risk. And this is where the art of improvising all the time. You see, there's a nice little shot where I've gone the other side of the white again with the opposite side. That was right hand side. And a lot of these points, if you were watching live, you perhaps wouldn't really be aware. Now you see I've got the white back towards behind the spot. Now I need to go further down the table. You see, now again there you've got to be very precise with your judgment, because I want to slip off both balls, and this is a tricky shot. Now, I was hoping to get the white, the red rather, a little easier to pot. So I've got to be brave here. And that's turned out perfect. So now you see we've got the white back after probably a dozen shots or more. We've got the white back to the position exactly where we started. When you play that sort of shot where you drift the red, you always want to make sure that you're striking really dead center and full ball on the red to get the main impact of the shot, which puts the nice solid pace into the red ball without hitting it hard at all. Left hand side again, thick on the red, but the side gives you the angle on the red. I might add also that the pockets on this table are very, very strict standard. They are not easy pockets. So you can imagine how, if you're fortunate enough, if that's the right phrase, to play on a table where the pockets really do give you far greater tolerance, you can see how it can make break making easy, by comparison anyway. Pinched a cannon there. And the other thing is, you notice that there was a lot of check side on that shot, but without any apparent effort. And that's purely pushing the cue through on the line of aim. That's all there is to it. Soft hold on the butt. All the elementary things that you learn at the beginning, but perhaps tend to forget on the road that you take. Again, feeling good, you can afford to do that. Don't do it until you're really buzzing. I might have to take the rest here. I'm stretching well. Again there, that was check side off the top cushion. So again you have to adjust the pace there because you lose a little bit of pace with the check off the cushion. So there you have to give it a fraction more. And I really mean a fraction. You can't take any liberties, there is nothing easy. Again there, the white was a little bit close to play underneath it from a long way away, so I've come forced it across the table to be on the best side to avoid that situation. Now perhaps I might be able to just go down the table a bit. That's it. The best I've ever had at this is 981, and that's without going away at all. And of course that's the whole idea of this, is if you can build up your average of, even just by putting the balls there in the set position, if you feel that you're pretty certain to make at least 50, 80, 90, 100 points, when it crops up in a match, it's a tremendous advantage. Being quite aware that if you have made some really big ones, you never know when it's going to happen. And of course one must accept that you do need good conditions. A lot of club tables you would find this very difficult to do, because you can't play the slow shots with the same certainty. And of course in modern times now you do get the occasional kick, which, well, you just cannot legislate for it at all. Now I've got options here, there's two or three shots here. And I've chose to play just with a little bit of stun effect there, just to get down the table a fraction. So left-hand side to keep me on course nicely. Now I can go down the table again. I can leave a pot. I had the option there, I could leave the pot as I have done, or I could have gone further down, play the cannon. I could still play the cannon, but there's a slight risk there. So there I've screwed back to give me the ideal situation rather than take the risk. So now it's under the white and we're back to normal. Just feather the white, hardly moved at all. I personally, I try as much as I can to avoid playing the screwback shots direct, only for the reason that I think there is occasionally you can perhaps have more risk of miscuing, and it intends to encourage maybe a little bit of snatch in the cueing. So therefore, always try to avoid it. If you can link up with a cannon and position the pot, now I'm in a position now where I've got to go away, so it's a very gentle in off. Now I've got to go back to hand. Unfortunately, with the one camera, you can't swing it round unless you have somebody with you. So now it's a long pot from the D, which is not too difficult. You see, in that, in your practice, I don't consider that going away. Going away is when the red goes away and you literally break up the basic position. Again, check side on that, and that's cut it very, it's a very thin one. A little bit of pace left in the cue ball, which has made it perfect. So now I've got the option of cannon, pot red, stun across. In fact, I've played it virtually no stun, lowish striking, and just rolled the red in, and it's given me the perfect angle. And don't forget to always try and address the cue ball where you mean to strike it. That was a better shot than it looked. There was drag on that with a hint of side just to keep the position right. That's just a simple pot. And of course you'll get spells when you're really playing well that you hardly have to use any side at all. Another time you'll find you're having to use side every other shot to maintain position. But don't let that worry you. You play the line and make all your adjustments for side. A wee bit more pace in the red there to get it off the side cushion, and it's come a little bit straight. They're the ones I'd sooner not play. Now then, a cover, bundles the side if I can get it on, and just missed the red, so there we are. That was a nice run there, and I think I got a slight kick there. Yes, well now the kick was on the cannon and not on the last shot. But if you look carefully, you'll see it was my fault that I missed the last shot, because it was on, but I just didn't raise the butt of my cue high enough to come down on the cue ball to give enough side, which would have given me a slightly thinner contact on the object ball, and hence I missed the second ball contact. So there we are. I've proved my own fault. So that was worth putting on. Now, in the next piece, I do get a kick, a real beauty. And to prove the point that I was trying to make, we've let it go on, although I do slip out of vision just for a moment, but you have to forgive that, but it does prove the point at the end. So let's have a look at that and see what you think.
Thank you.
very important on that pot there to relax and play with freedom. The inclination is, for most players, is to tighten up a little bit on the butt hand, and you find that you don't get the run on this ball. It's very important that, because there's a hint of running side on that, not to be actually put on physically, but just to address the ball slightly to the right and let it flow. It's very important that. Not a side on that one, not a running side to give me an angle off the red to get top side of the white ball. See a nice little clip on that yellow then. Actually, I wanted to be about here. A little bit short on that. Dead straight on that red. Had to really force that to get a little bit of side. I've just about cleared the red. Gee, that was a terrible kick I had there. That was perfectly played there, but I would have come up there and knocked the white to there and been quids in, but there we are. That's what can happen at this game. See if I can get out of it, but well, I caught the bump. So now, actually, I've been very fortunate. I can revert to open play now. Unfortunately, the camera doesn't allow. Maybe I can just swing it round very gently. I think maybe not. No, it's all set up, so I'll have to make the best of that. You'll have to trust me. So obviously the position I have is that the white is there, the red, which I intended to come down the table, miss the middle pocket and go and come back that way, which I think was had a fair chance. I caught the knuckle, went across there, and I've come back and landed perfectly here for a middle pocket pot. So now I have to retrieve the situation by going in off the white, getting it back behind the spot, and then potting the red and going up the top. I don't have to do that, but there you are. That's the idea of practicing at the top and how to get there quickly. So the white comes down. Just below the middle spot, so I'm going to take the long loser. I'm about 6 inches below the centre spot, slightly to the right. There we are, not bad. Level with the spot. Now again here, this is a point worth mentioning. This is purely preference for the player concerned. If I can quote an old pro, John Barry, who I used to play quite a bit with, jolly good player. He always liked to pot the red from in the centre pocket when he was running up in this situation to come off the top cushion and come back. And he used to play with a very confident pot. Not very difficult, agreed. But he liked the feeling of bouncing off there to there, which I can understand. It gave him, for his thinking, feeling of pace. He could judge the pace. Personally, I prefer to pot a gentle red and just roll up to wherever I want. I just prefer it. It's horses for courses. Now here again, you see I've recovered well from that very unfortunate kick that I had up there. I'm still well in play. But here's a situation where you see so many good players make a mistake. They've retrieved the situation maybe, got themselves back into a good position with the white near the spot. Not perfect, but it's not bad. And in their eagerness to get the white nearer, they would play this pot here and screw back to here to get underneath the white there. Now, underneath the white is the ideal shot to retrieve this situation. But the mistake is to do it in one shot. Don't immediately screw back because the pot is on. Screwbacks are never sure. So play two pots and play to get just on the line here. This is the important thing. Just get on or above the line, just low striking, and a nice, firm, confident shot. Now then, now you've got the pot, and you've got another pot, and this has gone as bad as it could possibly go. Now this gives a fair idea of just how tight a margin you're playing to at the top of the table. Now when I tell you that white now is a little bit awkward, I want it to be there. Now we're talking about less than half an inch, but it makes all the difference. So I'm compelled now to play not a screw back, but almost kill the white there and just come back an inch. And by keeping very close to the work, I can now play the most delicate of stuns, send the red to the side there. Now I can pop the red and go round, and I've scored, I don't know, 8, 9, 10 points, and achieved extra points and got into exactly the same position as when the red was there, and I could have screwed it in one, but I hadn't taken any risks. So now I just play the shot there under the white, send the white up, pop the red. And there we are, back in perfect position. Now I think that is an excellent time to stop to explain one of the strong points of playing top of the table. You know, I've always said that there is a time when you're playing, if you are very eager to play top of the table and play quality billiards, and I'm referring now to the old days, the good old days, I'm sorry to say that, but it's true, when the professional motto was never to overstay your welcome at the top, because there are so many little traps. And in the days when players made 1,000 breaks, very frequently indeed, it was too dangerous to give anybody an opportunity. It might be a 2,000 or 3,000 break, you know. So therefore, you had to be very, very tough in your discipline. And here is a perfect instance where, in trying to retrieve the situation now, as indeed, all through this break, forgive me for saying, but as well as I've played it, I have had little periods of struggle where the balls are not going quite as I would like, although I feel I'm playing very well. So, in a match where tension is at its height, you might well say, according to the situation of the match, you might say, well, they're not really going 100%. I've had 100 or something at the top. I'm going to go away and have a couple of in-offs and come back again. And that is the strength of the player of the past. They were so confident that they didn't wait at the top of the table to make the mistake and then try and retrieve the situation. They used to see the possibility of mistakes coming up in advance, and they would say, it's time to go away and start afresh. But the point is, they were so strong in their general play They never neglected their hazard play, their losing hazard play at all. So therefore, they would go away and they were dictating to the balls rather than the balls dictating to them. And that is the difference between, dare I say it, the modern player today at the moment and the player of the past who was of such a high standard. So there we are. So in a case like this, so that I can keep this as a point of demonstration, I mean, I don't want to go and mess it up. But not that I think I would, but in a very tight situation, let's imagine I'm a couple of hundred in front and there's 12, 15 minutes to go, and things aren't going as well as you're playing, and they're not really running for you. So you could very well do something like this. Push the white on the cushion. Run through to the corner. There you are. 3-6-9. And hold the table for a little bit of red ball. You eat up the time. You get your opponent anxious, and you're home and dry. So there we are, another little piece there where, well, you might find something interesting. I hope so, anyway. We're getting near the end of the tape now, and in this last piece that I'm trying to put together, I lost it with a bad shot, and fortunately the opportunity came up to run the balls together off the side cushion and see if I could get the cannons together, and I played it not too badly, so I've been able to run a few balls along the cushion, just go round the corner, and it gives you an idea of one of the positions where the opportunity occurs to pull them together. And I can assure you, in the old days, the masters were very adept at using this sort of method. So, and also, of course, there is a nice little recovery shot in this, which is worth noting. So we'll have a look at that now. Thank you. There we are, that's a little practice run. Nice there, just to get them together, take them along to there, round the corner, and if you're very serious and in good touch, go to the middle pocket. This is the last piece and we're getting to the end of the tape. Now, I thought it would be an idea to show you the full view of the table with playing around the spot, and it gives you perhaps a greater appreciation of why playing around the spot we have to concentrate with a single camera, because you do see in far greater detail what we're trying to portray. So I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you find it's been some benefit. All it remains for me to say is thanks to Roger Davies for getting behind the camera, which has enabled me to perhaps do as well as I've done in this on this occasion. So having said that, if you like it, if you want any more, it's up to you folk out there. You've got to say, well, we'd like more. Who knows, somebody else may pick up the idea and give billiards a little boost. So for the present, cheerio. Well now, I've put a stop to that. I looked like going on there, things were beginning to run nicely, but the main reason for me putting that on so that you could see the whole table is to give you the comparison of top of the table, which is what we're on about on this tape, where when you focus in with us just with the one camera, you can at least get a close-up of seeing what happens. You see the side that goes on, you can see the effects, whereas with a full table view, you can see the positions and the control and how to get above the balls to keep them at the top end of the table. That is the whole purpose of this this tape. And, you know, obviously it is for the better player, who likes to dabble at the top and perhaps, as I said previously, hasn't had enough success, put it that way. You always feel if you can get 20 or 30, why can't you get 40 or 50 or 60 or 70 or whatever? But the point is, don't worry about putting the balls in the correct position to start with. You know, if you want to make comparisons with other sports, if you just take Damon Hill, for instance, you know, he gets pole position in most of the Grand Prix that he drives in, when there isn't a competition, in fact. It's purely on your own, practicing, knowing what you are capable of doing. Now, believe me, that is one of the important factors of practice, which will encourage you to concentrate, and you will find that you will get involved because you are trying to do the best that you have ever done. In other words, if you've made 120 round the spot without going away, that's the point of the practice, you'd like to make 150 or 180 or whatever, and that drives you on, and that fact alone will give you the enthusiasm and the tightness within yourself to try harder and get good concentration. And believe me, that's all that it's about. And the same applies with red ball play. If you've made 50 off the red or whatever it is, you want to make 150 and so on. I mean, my personal best, and I don't say this as a boast, but years and donkey's years ago, I made 1,602 off the red. And the fact that I now, if I practice, I make 45 off the red without thinking about it. And that gets into your play, so that if suddenly you're at the top and you want to go away, and you think, oh dear, I've lost position. Instead of thinking, oh, I've lost position, you think, oh well, there's trouble here. Pop the red in off, send the red down to the middle somewhere, and you work yourself back into the top of the table. And you are in charge. And that's what it's about, because you know your capabilities. And believe me, I've been playing this a long time now, and that is what it's about. Don't worry, if your best break is 250 or 550, whether it's in practice or in match, as long as it's genuine and it's been executed well and you're happy with it, that is your best break. You be happy with it. It's about you, it's not about everybody else. So there we are. Practice and just don't get bored with it. If you want to think of it another way, just think that you've never made 100 break and you're playing in a game and you need 100 to win. Just think the difference in your mental attitude and your approach to the game that you're playing in. If you need that 100 and you've made hundreds before, you've made a 200 or whatever, do you not think that that will give you greater strength to get your head down and play because you know you're capable of it? And it doesn't mean to say because you've only done things in practice that you're going to win everything that you ever play, and of course you're not. But it's having your potential in the locker all the time. So just remember that, and you'll find that maybe when you need that little bit of extra something that other fellow always seems to have, he seems to win, maybe that's what it is. It's that little something inside you that says, come on, I know I can do it, I've done it before. And that is what you need. So there we are. I hope this will prove a little encouragement to you. And if it does, well, I shall feel happier about it as well. So all the best in the future. Just keep playing.